I'm very pleased to announce our speaker today. She is joining from Berlin. Today we are very happy to have Professor Olga Smirnova with us. She graduated from the physics department of the Moscow State University in 1996 and received her PhD there in 2000, continuing as an assistant professor. In 2003, she received the Lise Meitner Fellowship of the Austrian Science Foundation, and she joined then Vienna University of Technology as a postdoc. Afterwards, she moved to the National Research Council in Ottawa, Canada, where she became a permanent staff scientist in 2006. In 2009, she received the SAW Award of the Leibniz Society and moved to the Max Born Institute to establish her own strong field theory research group, which she continues to lead. And since 2016, she also holds a full professorship at the Technical University Berlin. In 2010, Olga has received the Karl Scheel Prize of the Physikalische Gesellschaft zu Berlin. And in 2020, she has received the Ahmed Zewail Award in ultrafast science and technology of the American Chemical Society. Olga's current research focuses on imaging and control of ultrafast electrodynamics in atoms, solid state materials and molecules, especially chiral molecules. So today we're looking forward to hearing about twisted and beautiful things. She's going to talk about chirality. And we are very, very happy to have you here, Olga, today. Thank you so much for supporting the initiative and accepting the invitation. So we're ready to start. The floor is yours. Feel free to take it.
Thank you very much, Carla, and the whole team of At the Fridays for the invitation. I'm very honored to be here and also very happy. So I will now share the screen so that you can see my slides. So I think you should be able now to see my slides. I will talk about ultrafast chirality, twisting light to twist electrons. So I first would like to thank my co-authors, and you will see that there is a lot of dynamics going on already on this slide. So my brilliant PhD student, Andres Ardanes, who moved from Berlin to Barcelona, and the postdoc, Emilio Pisanti, who moved from Barcelona to Berlin and actually soon is moving from Berlin to London. I would also like to thank my outstanding postdoc, David Ayuso, who moved from Berlin to London, and an amazing postdoc, Margarita Hachlova, who moved from London to Berlin. So Emilio and Margarita are postdocs in Misha's group. And Piero Di Cleva, I would like to thank for his contribution to our work. Piero is in University of Trieste. I would also like to thank my colleagues who contributed to this work, not directly, but via discussions, many discussions that we had with Bardot team, Paris team, and Hassel team, Philippe Demichen and Thomas Baumer. I also recommend the very nice papers, which are shown here, and they are also relevant for the talk. So one of the main messages is that nonlinear light-matter interaction leads to new extremely efficient chiral observables, which appear already in the electric dipole approximation. So I will present two vignettes today. First one about twisting electrons, and I will talk about geometric magnetism in photoionization of chiral molecules and new enantiosensitive observables in nonlinear photoionization. And the second vignette is about twisting light, and I will talk about synthetic chiral light, which is chiral in the electric dipole approximation, and structuring light hiddenness in space and time. And I will talk about chiral Young's double slit experiment and new enantiosensitive observables in nonlinear optical response. So now we start with the first topic. And here is the question that I would like to ask, which I think is very interesting to ask. So we know that in solids, nuclear configuration or lattice determines fundamental geometrical properties, such as the Beery curvature, topology, or anomalous observables, such as the Hall current. The question is, are there geometry-induced anomalous phenomena in molecules? And is there a common source of this phenomena, such as the geometric field? The naive picture, how I would think about this question, is the following, is that chiral molecules, they have additional purely geometric degrees of freedom, and this is handedness. And stereo arrangements of the nuclei define potentials in which electrons move. So they define tracks for electrons. And electrons moving along these tracks generate currents and fields. And these fields encode the geometry of tracks. So what I told you today is that this naive perspective is not that wrong in the end. And the answer to both of these questions is affirmative. Yes, there are geometry-induced anomalous phenomena in chiral molecules. Some of them are known but not recognized as such. Some have never been looked at, but they are spectacular, and I will talk about them today. So I will be talking about photonization, and the key 90-sensitive phenomena in molecular photonization is so-called photoelectron circular dichroism. In photoelectron circular dichroism, circularly polarized field liberates the electron, which goes to the detector with some momentum k. And if you put two detectors which collect electrons along the propagation axis of your pulse that created these electrons, in randomly oriented ensemble of molecules, you will see that more electrons will be going to forward direction than to backward direction, for example, for right molecules. And for left molecules, more electrons will go to the backward detector than to the forward detector. I just realized that I did not introduce chiral molecules. And although it is, maybe you know it, let me remind you that chiral molecules, they are like our hands, left and right, and they are two non-superimposable mirror images of each other. So it is very hard to distinguish chiral molecules, and the photoelectron circular dichroism is a method which is extremely efficient, and that is why, of course, it's very interesting to look at it. So the 90-sensitive signal, this forward-backward asymmetry in the electron emission, or the appearance of net photoelectron current along the light propagation direction, is very strong. It is of the order, it can be of the order of the total signal. So PECD is an extremely efficient probe of molecular chirality. But what I told you so far is well known. What I'll tell you today is that PECD is a manifestation of geometric magnetism. And PECD is generated by the flux of the geometric field. And this is not the only news. The other news, bigger news, is that PECD is only a tip of the iceberg. And the iceberg is the geometric field and new classes of 90-sensitive observables that it underlies. So the PECD current, the one I introduced just a few slides ago, can be written in the following way, that it's proportional to the chiral conductivity and to the product of basically two orthogonal components of the circularly polarized field. So the conductivity is a property of the molecule, and it can be expressed as a flux of a certain field through the sphere and sphere is in the electron momentum space. The radius of the sphere is determined by the absolute modulus of the photoelectron momentum. And the field itself can be written via vector product of the photoionization dipole and its complex conjugate value. Photoionization dipole is a dipole which contains the ground and a continuum state. So the field B is independent of light properties. It is defined in the molecular frame, and it's unique to a molecule. Its flux quantifies the chiral response in photoelectron circular deep rising. Now, I would like to connect this field to another geometric field, which is long known in solids. And the basis for comparison of photoionization of molecules the solids is these two cartoons. So on the right-hand side, you see a cartoon which shows two surfaces in momentum space. So the lower surface is the valence band of a solid, and the upper surface is the conduction band of the solid. And suppose we have a two-band solid. On the left, you also see two surfaces in the momentum space. This is the surfaces which correspond to the molecular photoionization. The ground state does not depend on K, and therefore this surface is completely degenerate, but the continuum is parabolic in K, and that's what you see here. So the laser-driven interband transition in solids are in a way similar to photoionization of molecules. What we found is that geometric field in molecular photoionization that I have introduced in the previous slide, which can be written either in the dipole gauge or in the velocity gauge, looks very similar to the Berry curvature in the two-band solid. Indeed, this expression and this expression are virtually identical. Here you have matrix element connecting the valence and conduction band, and here you have matrix element connecting the ground state and the continuum state. So both of these effects have actually geometric nature, and they reflect curly twisted polarizations or curly twisted currents. And the parallels between them run deep. For example, there is an analog of PECD in photoionization of molecules in non-center symmetric solids, which is known as circular photogalvanic effect. What happens is that if you excite this interband transition by circular polarized field and you look at the current, it turns out that net current, which is directed along the propagation of the circular polarized light, propagation direction, can be written in this form, which is identical to this one. And even more, the conductivity is a flux of the Berry curvature through the surface of the brilliant zone. So this expression is exact for two-band solid. Now, the field, the geometric field that we have introduced, it can show up already in photoionization from a single time event, which means real bound state. And in this case, it merges due to electronic structure. It should be curly electronic structure. And in this case, interestingly, only its radial component integrates to a non-zero value, which is flux, quantifying PECD. That's what I told you before. So what you see on this picture is the field for the first excited bound state of propylene oxide, a chiral molecule propylene oxide. And what you see here is the sphere and momentum space. So these are the coordinates. And for every point on the sphere, which means for every direction of vector k for a certain energy, fixed energy, we can find a vector B. So it's a vector field. Now you see that the brightness, this red arrows, and also the size of the arrow corresponds to the size of this vector. And of course, also reflects the direction. So if I now take radial component of all these vectors, so projection on the radial axis, then I will find out that in total, it's non-zero. But all other components and the field in total, if you would add them, would be zero. So now we could imagine a different situation in which we have, for example, a linearly polarized compulse, which excite a superposition of states in our chiral molecule. And after a certain delay, chiral currents evolve in the molecule. And then we probe them with circularly polarized pulse, just as before, but we are not probing a single stationary state. We probe a superposition. So what you will see, the geometric field can be generated by ultra-fast twisted electronic or vibronic currents. And dynamics, which evolves here, it offers us control over the geometric field, its direction, its structure, and also over the phenomena that it induces. So in a case when two states, when photonization happens, for example, from two states, this is the simplest case of a superposition, the geometric field is proportional, involves the coherence between these two states, which is simply proportional to the energy separation times delay. And also it involves vector product of photonization dipoles from each of these states. So in the pump probe setup, this field emerges both due to curly electronic structure and twisted currents. And thanks to currents, not only the radial component of the field, but also the whole vector integrates to non-zero value. And this leads to a new class of enantiosensitive observables. So what you see here is a geometric field for superposition of Luma and Luma plus one in propylene oxide. So geometric field generated by chiral dynamics at frequency, at given frequency between two states, can be represented in the form of quadratures. So basically, quadratures are useful because Q quadrature, which is usually coordinate, it characterizes rotational asymmetry due to electron density. So it characterizes curly polarization. And P quadrature, which is normally momentum quadrature, characterizes rotational asymmetry due to electron dynamics. So it characterizes twisted current. And it's also useful to present these quadratures in such a way that we make them the symmetries evident. For example, we can introduce symmetric and anti-symmetric quadratures with respect to inversion of a K of the electron momentum. And we can introduce symmetric and anti-symmetric combinations corresponding to symmetric combination of left and right, symmetric combination of Q and P quadratures in left and right molecules. So now the geometric field is characterized by its global invariant. So these are quantities which are non-zero upon integration over all directions of photoelectron momentum. And the first global invariant, which is simply the field as is integrated over all directions of momentum, it's a characteristics of the molecular core because the photoelectron is traced out. And it's very interesting to look at this first invariant. So we need to average over all directions of photoelectron momentum for fixed energy. And that's what you see here. This is the expression of my field through the symmetric and antisymmetric P and Q quadratures. Now, what is obvious is that antisymmetric quadratures with respect to K will of course disappear because we integrate over all K. But what is also curious is that symmetric in K quadrature, which should add up, for example, from upper and lower hemisphere, also does not survive. And it does not survive because there is a very strict condition on the existence of this global invariant. And time reversal symmetry of molecular bound states is crucial. So in real bound states, this turns into zero. And this thing, which arises due to currents because it's a P quadrature, P momentum is current. And so which means that only in the case when you have time odd states, the new dynamical and anti-sensitive observables can appear. So both the geometric field and its global invariant have been overlooked until now. So now I will tell you what are these new observables that appear. There is a whole class, but I will speak about one specific observable, which is molecular orientation circular decreasing. And new effect is in anti-sensitive orientation by ionization. So how does it happen? We come with the linearly polarized field, the chiral current evolves, and therefore the momentum quadrature of the field builds up. And then we, after delay, we photoionize with the circular probe, and this momentum quadrature leads to preferred orientation of molecular ions. So how does it happen? Why there is a preferred orientation? So linearly polarized pump excites bound electron current and the geometric field. Molecules where this geometric field is oriented along the propagation axis of the circular probe will be preferentially ionized. The reason why this happens is because the current, the rotation of the circularly polarized field is sensitive to the rotation of the current in bound states due to propensity rules. And in one photon regime, which we consider here, the core rotating current is preferred with respect to counter rotating one. Now, suppose we have two molecules which are shown here in exact opposite orientations, and they are both right enantiomers. If I used linearly polarized field, it induces the current in the molecule. But because the molecule is chiral, so current, for example, goes from one side of molecule to the other, but because the molecule is chiral, it converts this linear current into like a corkscrew, into a circular current. But because the direction of linear current is the same in the molecular frame of each of these molecules, it means that for molecule which has opposite direction to that one, current will be going in opposite direction. And because we have basically the corkscrew that we have is right, it means that it corresponds to current rotating in opposite direction. And now circularly polarized light prefers this molecule with respect to this one. So this, how large is this effect? First of all, it's effect which arises in the electric dipole approximation. In principle, it should be similar order to PCD. And here is our preliminary results. For propylene oxide, we excited LUMA and LUMA plus one orbitals. And here is the result for the orientation angle. So the orientation angle is the angle between this vector, which goes along the direction of geometric field, and the axis of the light propagation. So what you see here is this figure, minus 0.12 for this specific energy, which means that roughly out of 100 ions produced, 60 will have the vector in the lower hemisphere and 40 will have the vector in upper hemisphere. So it's a large effect. So orbitals excited by what is also interesting, that specific superposition that you excite, it defines the direction of geometric field and the direction of molecular irradiation upon photonization, which means you can control the field and you can control the observables that you get. So that's a final slide of this part of the story. And what I find is also very important is that the geometric field allows one to classify observables in photoionization and what we can, according to its global invariant. What we consider today is the class one observables, which are completely new, and they are based on the net geometric field and can only happen due to current. The class two observables, they rely on the net radial component of the field. I told you this. So this is PECD effect due to chiral density and time-dependent PECD, which also appear due to chiral current. So there will be Q and Q minus and P minus quadrature is responsible for this. And finally, class three represents an entire ad infinitum array of chiral observables, which are tensorial observables. And they basically correspond to rely on multipolar expansion of the B field. So of the geometric field, what you see here is that you can, for example, take the orthogonal component. So basically field has radial component and two tangential components. Radial component we already considered here. And what we can say, so we here projected on K, but we can also make an expansion of this component into spherical harmonics because this component itself is a scalar density. So we expand it into spherical harmonic and we get these tensorial quantities. The same we can do for transversal component and for the other transversal component. Here they are. So these are multipolar PCD currents and some of them corresponding to L1 and M equals zero have been observed and predicted in the paper by Demehin and Baumert and also in the Bardot paper by Rosen in PREX 19. But the rest are still there to explore. So my conclusions for this part are that new 90 sensitive observable of class one are messengers of charge-directed photoreactivity in chiral molecules. This is an important topic in after second science. X-ray can generate site-selective core excitation, and this may allow one to control direction of excited currents, orienting molecular ions along a desired direction. And the required setup for this linear polarized pump and circular probe. General geometric magnetism underlies, well, I wouldn't say all, it underlies a lot of the 90 sensitive observables in photoionization and enables new phenomena. Now, let me move to the obviously new questions and directions is the connection between the topology of the geometric field and photoionization and topological properties of molecular states, quantized chiral observables basically could possibly be induced using this link between topology and chirality, which is we have here via this geometric field and via currents in molecules. Now, let me move to the second part. I hope to be very quick with this one. So Kyle Young's double slit experiment, what do I mean? Suppose we have two emitters. That's what we usually have in a double slit experiment. And in our case, our emitters are chiral. which means that we have left emitter and right emitter. What does it mean? It means that each of these emitters have two components of the field. A chiral component of the field is out of phase in two emitters. So because emitters have opposite handedness. And a chiral component, because it's a chiral, is exactly the same in these two emitters. And what you see here, the phi, is simply the phase between the chiral, this one, chiral, and a chiral component. And this psi simply specify the handedness of emitters. Now, obviously, as you see from this figure, the chiral component is odd in X, and X is this coordinate which goes basically along the axis on which we have our emitters. So this is the emission. And a chiral emission is even in X, which means, of course, that if we add chiral emission and a chiral emission, we get bending. We get enantiosensitive light bending. The light bends from this chiral double slit experiment, the light bends either to the left or to the right, depending on the sequence of emitters. What is interesting that in total, this is not a chiral object because the left and right are totally compensated, equal amount of left and right emitters. But nevertheless, it shows chiral properties because in overall chiral medium, the detection of bending distinguishes left on right or right left arrangements of emitters. And here we see the new observable is a enantiosensitive light bending. And to understand better how it happens and to control this observable, it's useful to understand the underlying phenomenon, which we call polarization of chirality. So it's very useful to compare chirality as a property to the charge as a property. So what you see here is a sequence of charged units, and they have all positive sign. So we call this charged chain, right? But we can also have a neutral chain, minus, plus, minus, plus, etc. What we also usually can have is a charge polarized chain if we shift negative and positive emitters, negative and positive charges with respect to each other. So this is a polarized chain, and we have dipoles here. Analogously, we can have a sequence of chiral units. We can have sequence of racemic units where left and right, basically go one after another, and they are at the same distance. And if we shift left and right units towards each other, we get chirality polarized medium. So racemic medium can be chirality polarized, just like one can polarize a neutral medium by applying electric field. And chirality polarized chain of emitters is a multi-slit version of chiral double slit setup, as you can see here. Now the question is how to create chirality polarized emitters. So that's my question, and I answer that one can use chirality polarized light. And now you can answer, now you can ask me, what is the chirality polarized light? And I would answer that chirality polarized light is locally chiral light with structured handedness. And then you should ask, what is the locally chiral light? And then I just get to show you this movies that I really like very much, movies made by Andrés Ardanes. So locally chiral field is fundamentally different from naturally chiral light, which you see in this movie. So in this naturally chiral light, you see helix. This red arrow is simply polarization of the circularly polarized light. And this axis is the direction of propagation, and light makes helix as it propagates in space. So helix is good, but it's non-local in a sense that if we make a dipole approximation, then this helix completely disappears because, yeah, so you have just this situation, obviously. Now, what we wanted to have is a chiral light which would be locally chiral. Chiral already in electric dipole approximation. And what we have realized that for that electric field vector, which is also red arrow on this graph, it should draw a three-dimensional chiral structure in time, everywhere in space. So the three-dimensional chiral structure can be helix, as you see on this movie, or it can be any other chiral structure. So this helix can maintain its handedness globally, or its handedness can be structured in space. Both things are actually very interesting. So a 90-sensitive optical response in this case arises already in electric dipole approximation and can be fully controlled by controlling temporal structure of light, basically by controlling light Lesage figure. So now I would like to show you the light that we used to create chiral multi-slit setup. And this is this light in which we have elliptically polarized field in XY plane, and two omega field orthogonally polarized to the plane of polarization of omega field. And this is the chiral Lesage figure that is drawn by this field. And handedness can be controlled by the relative phase between omega and two omega fields. Now, the total omega field, so what I should tell you that this setup is actually possible to realize in the experiment. And that is the setup. So you need two non-collinear beams. In each beam, you have omega field, this red one, which is polarized in the propagation plane, and two omega field, which is polarized orthogonally to it. And when you recombine these two fields, they joint action results to the situation in which you get elliptically polarized omega field, and the elliptically polarized omega field, of course, carries spin. So, and the spin is actually at the frequency two omega. But now we also have two omega field, which is a vector collinear with this spin. And the product of this spin and vector of field one to omega, this is the quantity which describes the headedness of this light. And you, in this setup, because it's a non-collinear setup, you have a grating across the focus. And this grating corresponds to the grating of the spin and to the grating of the two omega field. And everything, the headedness, because it's a product, it depends on the relative position of two gratings, which you can change as you will. And for this particular configuration that you see here, we realize chiral Young's multi-slit experiment. Now, this is the last figure which relates to multi-slit experiment. We show that if we apply such light to randomly oriented molecular medium, and that was again, I think, propylene oxide, and these are the parameters for the omega beam, and two omega beam was much weaker. So what you see is what we demonstrate is the 90th sensitive bending of the 12th harmonic of this driving field. And you see that in right molecules, this harmonic goes to the right, and in left molecules, harmonic goes to the left, and divergence is very significant at the 1 degree for each. So this is a new 90 sensitive observable very strong effect. Not only harmonic 12, of course, behaves this way. You can tweak the phases between omega to omega field to basically make any harmonic you want, any even harmonic you want, to behave this way. So, and finally, this is my last two slides. Margarita and Emilio, they have come up with another configuration of fields, which actually allows one to realize truly double slit setup, so that the handedness of the field indeed changes in space exactly like one would want to do in the left and right, in the chiral Young's double slit. And to implement this, they employed tightly focused three-color fields. And these pretty, extremely nice pictures show you the Lesage figures. Green is for green emit, so basically on this part, on the positive direction across the focus. And magenta is for the negative direction across the focus. That's how they evolve across the focus, but they have exact same handedness to the right and to the left. So you can check it in this archive. And what they found is an interesting twist, because what I showed to you how to do highly nonlinear response in relatively strong field. And what they wanted to have really weak field, which does not perturb the sample too much. So they tightly focused. So first they excite the molecule into an excited state using UV light. And then they apply the scheme, which is the tightly focused three color fields. And you see the frequencies here. And then they look at free induction decay. And results are really spectacular, because they show that the free induction decay, of course, bends to the right for right molecules. And you see here integrated intensity versus divergence, and bends to the left for left molecules. Here, the divergence is only two times less, so it's about half of degree, but this is completely non-perturbative process, which does not disturb systems so much, and it's also beneficial. So that's my last slide. So it's exactly 40 minutes. We introduced the concept of polarization of chirality and new observables taking advantage of distribution of handedness in space, light with structured handedness, chirality polarized light, chiral Young multi and double slit setup and its realization, leading to enantiosensitive light bending in high harmonic generation and free induction decay, which can be used as an ultra-fast chiral probe. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Olga, for this really nice talk. I can see the questions are coming. So before we start, because we have people joining from everywhere, I'm going to launch a poll, and we would like to know from where you're joining. And while you reply, I would like also to make an announcement, actually two announcements. The first announcement is that for 2022, we are starting what we are going to call Hot Topics sessions. They are aimed at early career researchers. So if you would like to talk, these are going to be 2 plus 25 plus 5 minute talks on a Friday. I'm posting on the chat the information for you, so that you can see actually the details. Also, if you are a PI and you have a good postdoc or PhD student who would like to chat, do let us know. And another announcement is that we are still accepting contributions to our special issue in European Physical Journal D, Quantum Aspects of Outer Science. We accept also review articles and tutorials. Because of the disruption caused by the pandemic, we had the deadline extended up to January. And do feel free to make a contribution as well if you like to. It's growing strong, and there are already quite nice articles. And I'm going to end the poll and start the questions and offer announcements. So people are mostly joining from Europe and Asia, but we also have some people from US and Canada, and also from Latin America. And not from the other places though. So I'll stop sharing and we're going to start. And the first question that we have is from Upendra Harbola. It's an interesting work. I just have a comment. My work is on studying conductance in molecular junctions. We have also observed that geometric Berry fields can induce currents in periodically driven molecular junctions. This current can be tuned by changing phase difference between periodic drivings. I would like to know if something similar is possible to control currents in molecules using chiral light. Thank you.
So indeed, you can control currents and polarizations in molecules. I did not talk about this today, but basically this paper in Nature Photonics discussed just that. So basically what you can do is that how it happens. So I showed you that we have field which is chiral, which has component along rotating in this direction and oscillating orthogonal to it. So component rotating in this direction is able to induce chiral polarization, which is orthogonal to the plane of rotation. But 2-omega field is able to induce a chiral polarization, which is oscillating like this. So when you add them, you can either kill this one or enhance it, because this chiral component is opposite enantiomers. So if they are in phase in one enantiomer, they will be out of phase in the other enantiomer. That allows you to control polarization and, of course, currents as a derivative of polarization.
Okay, thanks. Am I audible?
Yes, feel free to speak. And if you want
to ask a question. Thanks, I just want to know that, you know, you have a chiral field or circularly polarized light, basically. So as I see it, you have these X and Y components of this field, which are out of phase, right? So, I mean, can I tune this phase difference or change the chirality the polarization, circular polarization of the field, which can be used to control these currents? Is that possible?
Just a second. I think I a little bit missed the beginning. So you said that you would like to control the polarization. So we have this component and this component, and you would like to control this component, right? The ellipticity, basically. Is that correct?
Yes.
Can do it. And this is, let me show you how this can be done. This is controlled by this angle. So you see opening angle between the beams. The bigger you make the angle, the larger ellipticity. The smaller you make the angle, the smaller is ellipticity.
All right, thank you. Thanks.
We also have something from Alieza Martinez Mesa. To what extent is chiral polarization spatially localized? Is there any estimation of what is the distance from the emitters between beyond which the chirality fades off?
So in all cases, this is a dipole emission. So the same, basically, the same thing that you have in, Landau number 2 volume for the spatial distribution of dipole emission, the same will be here.
Is that okay, or would you like to ask further? Do feel free to elaborate if you wish. That's fine. I think it is.
Hi.
Go ahead.
No, it's, I just wanted to establish or to know better whether to which extent is this analogy continue. I'm sorry, I'm at home. This is to which extent is valid the analogy with the charge distribution you show? Because and if you have this different multiple moments in of the electric field, then you have that the charge is long range, it's going to feel a long range, but the dipole field is a shorter range. I want to know if the similar relation was also valid for the case of the higher light.
Yeah, of course, there is no Coulomb contribution. No, not at all.
No, but what I mean is whether the chirality is more extended in space for the case you have, for example, a chain of chiral molecules, or you have these kind of dipole structures.
Ah, okay. So you mean if I would have two neutral molecules and you are interested what is the interaction between one neutral molecule and the other neutral molecules, I form a chain of them, say left, right, left, right. So basically the van der Waals forces between the chiral molecules, they are, of course, there are 90 sensitive ones, and the left and right molecule interact with each other, not in the same way as the left and left molecule. I only forgot, I think left and right attract and left and left repel, but I forgot this. I can give you a reference. This is basically a book, which is called Quantum Electrodynamics of Chiral Molecules. And there it's basically discussed in very detail.
Is that fine?
Yeah, it's perfect, fine, thank you.
Yes, so we have Vitaly Avebuk. Thanks, Olga. Have you considered a straightforward chemical optimization of the chirality effects by simply choosing molecular targets with larger transition dipoles? For example, looking at the possible combination of bond conjugation and chirality that does not have to involve a single asymmetric carbon center? Vitaly, also you raised your hand, so if you
I'm for the first time here, so I don't actually know what I'm allowed to do, what I'm not allowed to do. I also raised my hand just in case. So maybe as I'm speaking, anyhow, what I'm thinking about is a bridge to the, maybe it's more like a bridge to the solid state. Imagine you have a large chiral and conjugated system, which is probably carbon nanotube with the appropriate indices, so it is chiral. In this limit, do we obtain something that solid state physics already knows for a long time, or do we magnify strongly, possibly the unknown effects?
Basically, what we rely on is nonlinear effects, and this is normally not what is used. So in this sense, there are chiral effects in solids, and in terms of light-matter interaction, they are usually based on exploiting both electric and magnetic field. For example, there is this effect which is called chiral anomaly in Weyl semimetals, which is induced by the collinear electric and magnetic fields. What we could do, we could use our synthetic light and look at the same effect where basically you can change the chirality of a quasi-particle from, say, left to right. So we could use the same effect, but work in nonlinear regime. And this would be a completely new thing because, first of all, it will be talking to angular momentum, not to spin. And second, it will reflect a completely different complementary side of the system because it's all nonlinear. So I'm almost very confident that at nonlinear chiral interactions, people did not look like in solids yet.
So that's absolutely fantastic then, because you can maybe instead of your toy molecules, which you on which you did all these great demonstrations, maybe you could think of extended systems which still have chirality and magnify these effects times many.
Yeah, I think it's a very interesting thought, a very interesting direction to look at. Thank you. Actually, all Thank questions you. Are great. Thank you so much for questions.
Thank
I'm
you very
really
much.
Enjoying, yeah. Really enjoying it.
Thank you.
Are there more questions? Andres Tautis just complimented you on the talk, but unfortunately had to leave. So thank you, Olga, for an exceptionally beautiful talk, as usual, if that's not a paradox. And he's thanking also us for organizing the seminars. Is there anyone else who would like to ask anything? Or Avijit Datta would like to talk? Yes, go ahead. You can speak. We have allowed you to, in case you wish. He had some, I don't know, disappeared. Yeah, I don't know what is going on, because I asked them to speak, but then it was gone suddenly. And Alianza would like to speak further. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, it's just come to my mind. It's highly speculative, but I mean, all the if I understood correctly, all the data you have shown today, you average over different orientations of the molecule. So to be sure, this is a property of the light and not of the inherent chirality of the molecule. So my question would be, whether you made these molecules lie on the surface that has an intrinsic chirality that is contrary to the one that the molecules have, for example. Is there a way to foresee which of the two orientations will prevail, or? Because chiral light is able to compensate for the random orientation, but whether if they are trying, there's an external field that tries to reverse this handedness.
Basically what you are talking about is that chiral molecules on the surface, right?
Yes.
And the surface is also chiral, right?
Yes.
Uh-huh. And the question is, if I apply a chiral light, yeah, it still will be, of course, energy-sensitive interaction, because three energy-sensitive objects will interact. So say molecule is a solid, and then light, this molecule and this is solid, it has to be energy-sensitive to have the effect, that I described. You need a current in the molecule, so you need the dynamics in the molecule, you need to have a time-out system. And in this case, the orientation is a little bit, I don't think I will be topical, because molecule is already more or less on the surface, so it's already probably fixed in space. Or yeah, if you would consider that you put all molecules in all different directions, then yes, you will be able to probe basically the most efficient direction of molecular corkscrew, because this most efficient direction will show the orientation. Yeah, so that's also possible.
Okay, thanks. I guess I understood. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
So I think we have a lot of questions. I'm really pleased to see all of you being really active and interacting with our speaker today. I would like to thank Professor Smirnova for speaking at our seminar series, and I would like to thank all of you for your support. And for you who are watching on YouTube, have a great weekend and hope to see you next time, and stay safe.